Hello everyone, welcome to Unacademy, India's largest online learning platform. Let's crack UPSC CSC English. Now, it's been quite long that we have conducted any sessions. So, hope so your preparation is going quite well. Everyone is fine. Now, basically, before I start the session, let me introduce myself for the people who are new on the platform or who are attending my session for the first time. My name is Alok Ojha. I have done my engineering from Pune. I have been associated with the field of UPSC since past 6 to 7 years. I hold the experience of going through various stages of civil services exam. I also hold the experience of exams like CDS, CAPF Assistant Commandant and Uttar Pradesh PSC. I am involved into the field of teaching since past 5 years and I have mentored more than 15,000 aspirants for UPSC. Now, before I start with a very dynamic topic today, that is Sufism. Let me talk about the platform in short. Like, there might be question in the mind of an aspirant why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. Here are the ample of reasons why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. First of all, you'll have daily live classes on the Unacademy platform. Unacademy offers you assimilation of top and dynamic educators of India on a single platform. You can directly interact with the educators. You can clear all sorts of doubts with the educators. Second most important aspect, which I personally believe is very important for an aspirant, and that aspect is basically building up competence or competitiveness. Now, why competence or competitiveness is important? Let us understand this. Each year, approximately around 1 million aspirants aspire for the prestigious civil services exam. Now, approximately around 3 to 4 lakh students appear for the prelims exam. 8 to 10,000 qualify the prelims exam. 3 to 4,000 qualify the mains exam. And finally, 800 to 1,000 odd make into the final list. So if I filter it down, one aspirant is competing with 800 to 900 other aspirant. And in that case, he needs to build up that sort of competitiveness or competence. Unacademy helps to build up your competence by going through live tests and quizzes. All the courses on Unacademy platform are highly structured in nature and there is a proper timetable through which the courses are being conducted. One can have unlimited access to the courses on Unacademy platform. Here are the few top and dynamic educators of India from whom you are going to learn through. Subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. Now, basically, there is also a wide range of optionals that are being covered on Unacademy. It also covers various technical optionals. Apart from that, various literature optionals are also being covered on a platform of Unacademy, like Kannada literature, Maithili literature, English literature, Hindi literature. These optionals are covered in a very systematic format. Secondly, there is a lot of focus on the humanities subject as well, like public administration, sociology, psychology, and so on. Now, these are the fees basically for the structure of the optional. Like, the fees for 24 months for the optional basically is around 40,000. And for GS, it is basically around 72,000. For 3 years, the fees for the optional is approximately around 50,000. And for the GS is approximately around 90,000. To avail the benefits of subscription, please use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Now, these are the basic special classes that I have conducted previously. Yes, guys, now let's get started with Sufism. Now, before I start with Sufism, let me give you a brief introduction of Islam in short. I have already covered a session on Islam and the early Muslim invaders as a lecture on the YouTube basically. But I'll give a brief introduction basically in short about the Islam. So please listen to me patiently. Please listen to me carefully. All your doubts would be clear. The word Islam basically means surrender to one particular entity. And that entity is Allah. The birth of Islam took place at Makkah. And the pioneer of Islam was Prophet Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad was born to Abdullah and Amina. In very simple words, Abdullah was father of Prophet Muhammad. and Amina was mother of Prophet Muhammad. Like it is said that Prophet Muhammad was raised up by his uncle whose name was Abu Talib. And Abu Talib had one more son whose name was Ali. So in very simple words, Prophet Muhammad and Ali both are cousins. Now it is said that at the age of 25, Prophet Muhammad was married to a rich widow whose name was Khadija Begum. And by the age of 40, he realized that basically his purpose on earth is quite different. He has been sent by that one particular entity to spread the message of Islam. So basically, he considered himself as Nabi and Rasul. Nabi means perfect man. Why perfect man? Because he was chosen by the Allah. And Rasul means messenger. His teachings became quite famous in the region of Makkah. And now when he became famous in the region of Makkah, apart from the followers, there were many people who also opposed his thinking. Now, he had to migrate from Makkah to Medina. And the migration of Prophet Muhammad along with his followers from Makkah to Medina is referred as Hijra, which is the first year in the Muslim calendar. Now, the followers who migrated along with Prophet Muhammad from Makkah to Medina are referred as Muhajir. And those who welcomed him in Medina are referred as Ansar. Now it is said that Prophet Muhammad, he never chose his successor. But Prophet Muhammad was succeeded by Abu Bakr. I repeat, Prophet Muhammad was succeeded by Abu Bakr, who was father-in-law of Prophet Muhammad. Now, Abu Bakr was succeeded by Umar. Umar was succeeded by Usman, and finally Usman was succeeded by Ali. I repeat the points. Please listen to me carefully. Please remember the hierarchy. Prophet Muhammad was succeeded by Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr was succeeded by Umar. Umar by Usman, and Usman by Ali. The followers of Ali are referred as Shia and the rest are Sunni. Okay. Now, there are few principles which are core to the basics of Islam, like namaz. Like every follower of Islam should read namaz at least 5 times a day. Then there is something called as emphasis on rigorous fasting, which is also referred as roza. There is also something called as zakat. I repeat, zakat. What is zakat? Every Muslim have to give 2.5% of his income as a part of charity. I repeat, 2.5% of his income as a part of charity. I'll give you a very small example. Suppose if I earn rupees 100, I have to give 2.5 rupees as a part of charity, which would be utilized for the underprivileged section of the society. Then, in Islam, basically, consumption of alcohol basically is prohibited. Okay, why consumption of alcohol is being prohibited? Because after consuming alcohol, one loses his senses. And basically after losing the senses, he cannot follow the path which has been preached in the holy book, which has been preached by Prophet Muhammad. That is why consumption of alcohol is being prohibited in Islam. So these are the core principles of Islam. Okay, now there is also something called as Sufi movement and Bhakti movement. Now, Sufi and Bhakti movement also evolved around 9th and 10th century AD. Now, what is Sufi movement all about? Let us understand this. The word Sufi has been derived from the Arabic word Suf. And Suf basically means wool, which symbolizes purity. So there were few saints who propagated the teachings of Prophet Muhammad. And these saints basically came after the death of Prophet Muhammad. And these saints came to be referred as Sufi saint. I repeat, these saints came to be referred as Sufi saint. Why? Because they wore woolen clothes. And wool basically symbolizes purity. Now, there was a diversion from the mainstream Islam. I cannot say that there was a complete diversion from mainstream of Islam. But they did not focus majorly on the ritualistic practices. They majorly focused on the purity. They majorly focused on the liberal ideas of Islam, basically. Now, when did the Sufis arrive in India? Now, Sufi, it is said that after the invasion of Muhammad Ghori, I'll give you a small example, I'll go into the background. Muhammad bin Qasim was the first Muslim invader of India. And Muhammad bin Qasim did not had the intention to establish a permanent settlement in India. He only had the intention to plunder India. He was followed by Mahmud of Ghazni. Mahmud of Ghazni approximately conducted 17 raids in India. And the major purpose of his raids in India was basically to plunder India rather than establishing permanent settlement in India. And after that, there was arrival of Muhammad Ghori in India. And after the arrival of Muhammad Ghori, there was incoming of various Sufi saints from various Central Asian countries into India. Now, what did the Sufi saints believe in? They directly believed in the relation between God and the man. Now, they believed that in a very simple term, they believed that the relation between the Allah, that is God and the man, is not of the master and slave. The relation between the God and the man is a very pure relation. And that relation is basically like the relation between basically loved and the beloved one. Okay. Now basically it is said that they were completely opposed to the mystic. They were completely opposed to the rudimentary ideas of Islam. Okay. And they majorly focused on inner purity. Like the mainstream Islam focus on rigorous conduct. Like observing Rosa, going for namaz on 5 times. Okay. But they majorly focused on inner purity. They focused that if you show love and respect towards Allah, you will find that Allah is standing besides you. That is the major focus of the Sufi saints. So they laid greater emphasis on the inner purity rather than following the ritualistic part. My friends, I'm not saying that they were opposed to the ideas of Islam. Yes, they did follow the ideas of Islam, but they majorly focused on inner purities. Now, as per the Sufi saint, the major role in the life of a person is being played by a teacher. So teacher was referred as peer and the disciple was referred as murid. Peer means teacher, murid means disciple. So it is a duty of the teacher, it is a duty of the peer to teach the basically proper principles of the Islam to the basically whom? The disciple or the murid. Okay. Now basically the Sufi saints were basically categorized into two parts, Bashara and Beshara. I repeat, my friends, I have repeatedly said about the terminologies. And from the very first session of the Medieval India, I've told you one thing. Please focus on the terminologies. Because in the UPSC exam, there have been a lot of questions just on the terminologies. So majorly, you guys need to focus on the terminologies. Okay? So coming back. So basically, the Sufi saints were divided into two parts. Bashara and Beshara. Now what is Bashara? Bashara basically means those who were bound by the Islamic law. They had to follow the Sharia law. And Beshara. Beshara means they were not bound by the Islamic law. Okay. And now these saints basically focused on one concept. Wahadat ul Wajud. I repeat. Wahadat ul Wajud. And what is that basically? You will not find the God in the mosque. You will not find Allah basically in the dargah. Okay. God is pantheism. Like they believe in pantheism. In very simple words, God is present everywhere. And it is reflected in everyone. Okay. God is present in every entity. So what does it simply signify? This simply signifies one thing. That if you need to reach to the Allah, if you need to reach to the God, first of all, you should start working for the humanity. Why? Why one should start working for the humanity? Because God is present in every individual. And until and unless you respect the fellow individuals, how can you respect that God which is residing in that individual? So basically, they believe that God is present everywhere. Now, they organized khankas. Like in Hinduism, we have seen basically, like Hindu saints have mutt, okay, where basically the saints reside. Similarly, there is something called as khanka, okay. Now, khanka is basically a place where these saints reside, okay. And every khanka had a langar. What do you mean by langar? It is nothing but a holy feast. And every person, irrespective of his social background, irrespective of his or what we say economic background, can visit the saint, can visit the fakir, can visit the darvesh, can visit the Sufi saint. Darvesh, fakir, wali, all these are interchangeable terms for the Sufi saint. So anybody can visit this khanka and pay tribute to the Sufi saint. So the doors of the Sufi saint were open to all. They were open to everyone. And they believed in one important concept of inner purity. Why? Because they believed that it is not necessary to perform rigorous fasting. It is not necessary to go for reading namaz 5 times a day until and unless you develop that love and respect towards God. So they focused majorly on the inner purity. And they said it is a duty of the peer. Peer basically means what? The teacher, to make these concepts understand to the disciple, who is referred as murid. Okay, so khanka had a langar. Langar means it's a holy feast and everybody can have a food there. Now, later on with the passage of time, these khanka became an important centers of learning. Now, whenever a Sufi saint died, the disciples used to build a tomb around that place, and that was referred as Darga. I repeat, that holy place was referred as Darga. Okay? Now, basically they said that Sufis also believed in one important thing. Like in Hinduism, we have a practice of what we say bhajan and kirtan. In bhajan and kirtan, we sing song in the praise of the deity. We sing song in the praise of the God. Similarly here, basically songs are sung in the praise of Allah. So music played a very, very important role in the life of Sufi saint. And in fact, it is said that Qawwali, which is a pattern of music, which is a style of music, emerged during this period. And the musical congregation to praise the deity, to praise the Allah, was referred as Sama. I repeat, was referred as Sama. So my friends, by now I have talked about various, what we say, the terminologies. I'll repeat the terminologies, guys. The word Sufi has been derived from the word Suf, which means wool. Second major important aspect, the Sufi saints majorly focused upon the relationship between the God and the, what we say, the disciple. And the relation between the God and the disciple is like the loved and the beloved, and not the master and the slave. Secondly, they laid major emphasis on what? The role of teacher. So the teacher was designated as peer, and the disciples were designated as murid. Now the place where the Sufi saint resided was referred as khanka. Now, to come close to God, there was a musical congregation being held by various Sufi orders. These Sufi orders are referred as silsila. And the musical congregation that was held is referred as sama. My friends, did you understand the terminologies? Because as I have told you previously, terminologies plays a very, very crucial role in the medieval India. And majorly, you need to focus upon these terminologies. Hope so the points are clear, my friends. These are the early Sufi saints, which is factual in nature. And you need to remember the name of these Sufi saints. It is not necessary, because sometimes there might be a question in the mains exam about the role played by early Sufi saint. So you need to know about the early Sufi saints. So it is factual in nature and you guys need to know about that. And I've mentioned them about them in quite depth and detail. Okay. Now, what are the views of various writers about Sufism? Okay, as I have told you, Sufism and Bhakti movement, we are also going to study about one of the important movements in Hinduism, which is Bhakti movement. Both these movements focused on inner purity. And the most important side, which basically laid emphasis, most important aspect on which the Sufi saint laid emphasis was inner purity. Okay. And this was cited by K.D. Bhargav as well. Like they moved away. I'm not saying that they were opposed to the practices of Islam, but they believed that until and unless one's soul is pure, until and unless there is a purification of heart and the thoughts, okay, one cannot come close to Allah. If you guys remember one important aspect, we have discussed this aspect in the ancient India when we were discussing about what? We were discussing about Buddhism. If you remember one thing, guys, I have talked about certain principles or eightfold path in Buddhism. And one of the major aspects that I focused upon was right thought and right understanding. What does right thought says? One should keep away from empty rites and rituals. This was a practice of Buddhism, which is again reflected in the ideas and the ideology of what? Sufi saint. So what does this symbolize? This simply symbolizes Sufism. Although it talks about Islam, although it being a part of Islam, it also reflects the ideas of Hinduism. It reflects the ideas of Buddhism and to an extent of Christianity. That is why it is said that such a wonderful statement given by K.D. Bhargav, Muslim mysticism or Sufism may be regarded as love of supreme beauty. The thought of East and West converges in the fundamentals of love. Okay. Now, there is another historian whose name was Professor Arbery. He believed that basically Sufism is an attempt of an individual Muslim to realize the presence of Allah. I'll give you a very small example. It is not necessary that we need basically a mediator to reach the Allah. It is not necessary to go for rigorous ritualistic practices just to show love and respect towards Allah. I had previously given one statement that God is present everywhere and is reflected in everyone. In very simple words, the Lord resides in the heart of everyone. So, service to mankind, service to humanity is nothing but service to that God. So basically, here Professor Arbery needs to, like he's saying here basically, one should realize the presence of Allah within himself and within every being. Okay, like there was another person whose name was Fariduddin Attar. He wrote approximately around 114 books on Sufism, which is nothing but that book is referred as Tadhkirat Al-Awliya. I repeat, Tadhkirat Al-Awliya, which basically reflects the principles of Islam, which basically highlights the principles of Islam. And there was another, what we say, person whose name was Jalaluddin Rumi, who wrote Masnavi. It again provides a detailed information about the terminology associated with Sufism. Like we have discussed various practices of Sufism, like what is Peer, what is Murid, what is Wahdat ul Wajud. All these principles of Sufism are reflected in these book. Okay. Now there was another person whose name was Abdul Karim Al-Jili. Now he had wrote a book basically which highlights basically that there are four stages to attain basically or to basically become a Sufi saint. First is purification of self and purification of thought. Okay. I'll give you a very small example so that you can easily understand. I'm going to correlate this thing. Please pay attention properly. Please listen to me keenly because I'm saying one thing. I'm going to correlate the things. Why I'm going to correlate the things? Because Bhakti movement and Sufi movement. Bhakti movement which evolved in Hinduism and Sufi movement which evolved as a part of Islam are contemporary to each other. That is why basically I'm giving an example. I'm trying to correlate things. There was one saint, Bhakti saint. Okay, Ravidas ji. Now, I'm giving an example so that you can easily understand this. Why there is necessity of purity of self and purity of thought. Now, this is a hypothetical story, but a very wonderful story with a very wonderful and deep message. Okay. Now, this Bhakti saint was sitting under a tree, and there was one saint going through there, that place. One Hindu saint going through that place. Now, basically, his slipper had, because of the friction, his slipper had torn apart. And he came to Ravidas ji and asked him to repair his slipper. Now, by the time he was repairing the slipper, Ravidas ji asked him one simple aspect. Where are you going? He said that I'm going to take a holy bath in Ganges. Okay. And he just gave a simple taunting to that person that what would you know about the importance of holy bath? So he did not reply anything. Now, this saint moved away and he went to the river Ganges. When he was moving, Ravidas ji told him one thing, that please offer this 1 rupee to Mother Ganges. Okay. So he took that, and what happened basically, he went there, he had a dip in the holy Ganges. After having a dip in the holy Ganges, he was returning back. When he was returning back, he realized that person had given him a coin to offer to the Mother Ganges. And now he offered that coin to Mother Ganges. As soon as he offered the coin to Mother Ganges, what happened? To the astonishment of that saint, a bangle made of diamond came out and said that, please give this to my holy bhakt. And now the saint took it. When he was coming back, now he had an idea that rather than giving this to this person, why shouldn't I sell this to a king? Okay. So he went to the king and he gave to the king. King was very happy. The queen was very happy. When he was coming back, okay, he thought that king is going to reward me a lot of things. King gave him a bag of coins. King was ready to give him the bag of coins. By the time queen said, I want another pair of bangles. Okay, it's a hypothetical story, but with a very deep message, guys. So what happened basically? She said basically, I want another pair of the bangle. Now this, saint, he was very, what to do now? What should I do? So finally the king said, if you do not find another pair of bangle, I'm going to behead you. I'm going to kill you. Now the saint was worried what to do basically. So what happened basically? He told him the entire story. Now he came to that person and told him the entire thing, that I offered your coin and the Mother Ganges gave me the bangle. And now king is saying that if you do not get another pair of bangle, he is going to kill me. So what did this person do? He took a bowl of water. Okay. And after taking a bowl of water, because this person was carrying water from River Ganges, and asked him basically, please give me a bowl of water. After taking a bowl of water, he just offered prayer and again another bangle emerged. So this is nothing but what? It's a hypothetical story. But what deep message did we get from this story? Purity of thought, purity of heart. If you have to come close to God, the most important aspect that we need to remember is that we need to have purity of thought. Then we need to have a purification of heart and self. Then and then our soul will get illuminated. Then and then our spirit will get illuminated. And we need to move apart from this temporary world. Okay? So, these aspects which we are discussing in the Islam has been reflected in a very dynamic and wonderful manner in the Hinduism Vedanta philosophy. Okay? Wasn't the story wonderful, guys? Yes. So, hope so. Everyone is understanding the terminologies. Because as I have told you previously itself, terminologies plays a very, very major role. Basically, in the examination and specifically in the medieval India. Okay, so by now we have discussed a lot of terminologies. Now, let us discuss various Sufi orders or various Sufi silsila. Okay. The first Muslim invader of India was Muhammad bin Qasim. As I have told you, he did not had any sort of intention to establish permanent settlement in India. Followed by Muhammad bin Qasim was Mahmud of Ghazni. Now, Mahmud of Ghazni had only one intention in his mind, that is to plunder India, to loot India. And he conducted approximately around 17 raids in India. One of the most important raids being conducted by Mahmud of Ghazni was at Somnath Temple. Okay, he plundered the Somnath Temple, which was again being repaired by Bhim I, the Solanki dynasty ruler. Followed by that was Muhammad Ghori. Now, apart from plundering India, he also wanted to establish a permanent settlement in India. And after the reign of Muhammad Ghori, okay, it is said that there were various other Sufi saints who came to India. Okay, I'll give you a very small example how the ideas of Sufism are reflected during the reign of Muhammad Ghori. We have discussed this in quite depth and detail when we were discussing about the administration of Delhi Sultanate. Okay, when Muhammad Ghori was passing by the region of Ajmer, okay, now he saw that there were many Hindus who were praying. Now he asked one of his loyal slaves whose name was Qutubuddin Aibak to construct a mosque. But that mosque needs to be constructed within 2.5 days. It might be a hypothetical story. Okay. So Qutubuddin Aibak, the slave of Muhammad Ghori, constructed a mosque at Ajmer, which is also referred as Adhai Din Ka Jhopada. Okay. So this was one of the interesting story. Now it is said that right from the time of Muhammad Ghori came the various Sufi saints from various Central Asian countries. And one among them was Muinuddin Chishti. Okay. Now he said one important aspect. One should show love and respect towards Allah. One should show love and respect towards God to come nearer to the God. Rather than going for rigorous ritualistic practice, just show love and respect towards God. And second most important aspect, it is a duty to serve the underprivileged section of the society of every Sufi saint. Why? Because the earlier Sufi saints believed that the God resides within everyone. And when any person is in distress, and or when any person is a part of underprivileged section of the society, it is a duty of the saint, it is a duty of the people, basically, to help these people who are in distress. This is nothing but service to God. This is nothing but service to humanity and the mankind. And both are related to God. Why? Because service to God and mankind is nothing but service to humanity. Okay. Then basically, it is said that Muinuddin Chishti became quite famous when his tomb was being visited by Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Muhammad bin Tughlaq was one of the important rulers of Tughlaq dynasty. Like Tughlaq dynasty was being founded by Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, and he had a son named as Juna Khan or Muhammad bin Tughlaq. So Muhammad bin Tughlaq, after the death of Muinuddin Chishti, visited the holy tomb of Muinuddin Chishti. So basically, he became quite famous after that. Okay, and there was one ruler of Malwa. Malwa is in the southern part of Madhya Pradesh, whose name was Mahmud Khilji. He built a mosque in that region around in the 18th century. Now, what did basically Sufis believed in? I have told you one important aspect: simplicity of life, humility, selfless devotion to God. Renunciation of worldly possessions was regarded as significant for control of senses. Now, I'll give you a very simple aspect. If you remember Buddhism, in Buddhism also I have told you one important aspect. If you remember, in the ancient India we have discussed the terminology of Chaitya and Vihara. There were many people who were aspiring to learn the practices of Buddhism. Now, before learning the practices of Buddhism or before joining the Sangha, they need to renounce their worldly possessions. Similar practice was followed in Jainism as well. They need to renounce the worldly possessions. Why? Because if their mind is continuously clinging to the worldly possessions, they cannot focus on meditative practices. They cannot develop a control over the senses. And second major aspect, if their mind is continuously clinging towards the, what we say, worldly life, okay, they cannot go for service to humanity or the mankind. And one of the central theme of Sufism is service to humanity is service to Allah or God. So basically, one needs to completely renounce the worldly possessions. Then, selfless devotion to God, and one should have a benevolent attitude towards all, irrespective of the religion. For example, we, every one of us, belong to a same race, and that race is human race first. We belong to basically human race, and our first religion should be humanity. This was being focused by the Chishti saint. Why it is called as Chishti order? Because the order was being evolved by Muinuddin Chishti. Okay? Now, after Muinuddin Chishti, the another important saint who belonged to this Chishti silsila or the Chishti order was Baba Fariduddin Ganj-e-Shakar. I repeat, Baba Fariduddin Ganj-e-Shakar. And he settled himself in the region of Hansi, that is in Haryana. Now they believed in one important aspect. Religion and politics, both are different thing. There shouldn't be any interference of the state in religion and vice versa. In very simple words, the politics cannot be intermingled with religion and religion cannot be intermingled with politics. So they said that basically the Sufi saints should keep themselves away from the nobles. The Sufi saints should keep themselves away from the king. Because when they are in touch with the king and nobles, automatically the politics will enter into the religion. And this should not happen. Okay? So, Baba Fariduddin, who was also referred as Baba Farid. Now, he had a staunch devotee like Sultan Balban. As I have told you, although he said that the king should not dedicate basically, the Sufi saint should not be basically associate or befriend the Sultan. But still, he had a devotee in the form of Sultan Balban. Now, there is also one more reason which we'll study in the later part of this chapter, that why the Sufi saints should not befriend the kings and the nobles. Because after this, that we are going to study one important order which is called as Suharwardi order. Now, it is a duty of the Sufi saint basically to give equal treatment to all. Rather it be a pauper, that is a beggar, or a king, or a noble, or irrespective of a person, or a common man. Everybody is same in the eye of the God. Similarly, everybody should be same in the eye of the peer, that is a teacher. That is why Chishti said that everybody is same in the eye of the Sufi saint. Rather it be a king, rather it be a common man, rather it be a saint, rather it be a beggar, or irrespective of a person. Okay, now Baba Farid was being succeeded by Sheikh Nizamuddin Aulia. I repeat, Sheikh Nizamuddin Aulia. And Sheikh Nizamuddin Aulia was a disciple of Baba Farid or Baba Fariduddin. So please remember these names, because in the exam there might be a probable question. Sheikh Nizamuddin Aulia belonged to which silsila or belonged to which Sufi order? So he belonged to which order? Chishti silsila. Okay. Now I'll give you a very small example. Nizamuddin Aulia, he had seen the reign of seven sultan. Like basically he had seen the rule of seven sultan. But he did not had a good, what we say, terms with one of the sultan whose name was Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. Now I'll give you a small example why he did not had a good relation with Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. Let us understand this. Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq was a founder of Tughlaq dynasty. And when Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq became the sultan, he adopted a very stern policy. He adopted a very stern attitude towards the religion. I'll give you a very simple example. Like he started one policy under which basically it is said that whatever tributes were given to the Sufi saint or whatever donations, liberal donations that were being given by the previous rulers were retaken by Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. Why? were retaken by Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. Why? Because this money can be utilized for the administrative purpose. Now, Nizamuddin Aulia, he had received approximately 5 lakh tankas from the previous sultans, from the previous rulers. Okay. And he refused to give this back to Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. Why? Because he believed that these are a part of charity. And as I have told you previously, there was one system called as Langar system, which was nothing but holy feast, and everybody visited there. So basically it is said that Nizamuddin Aulia was a very revered and very respected Sufi saint. Okay. Now it is said that Sultan Alauddin Khilji aspired to meet Nizamuddin Aulia, but this person, Sufi saint Nizamuddin Aulia, refused to meet Alauddin Khilji. He said that I will not visit the Sultan because it is opposed to the dignity of the, what we say, Sufi saint. Because Sufi saint believe in a very simple life. They believe in a life of simplicity. And as I have told you previously, he had a very conflicting relations with Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. He is also referred as Mehboob-e-Illahi. I repeat, he is also referred as Mehboob-e-Illahi, which means beloved of the God. Okay. Now, Muhammad bin Tughlaq had another view about the Sufi saint. He believed that religion and state are twins. He wanted to combine priesthood with kingship. He wanted the Sufis to make their talent available to the state in execution of its policy. I'll give you a very small example. Like if you see the Delhi Sultanate, Qazi played a very major role. Now Qazi acted as a chief judge. Similarly, because the Qazi had the knowledge about the Islamic religion. So this person, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, aspired that the Sufi saints should also play a very major role in the administrative part. And their knowledge would be quite useful in the smooth functioning of the administration. But this was not followed by the saints of what we say Sufi order. Now, basically, Nizamuddin Aulia had a successor whose name was Sheikh Nasiruddin. Now, Sheikh Nasiruddin became a part of the court of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Now, it is said that he was offered food in a golden plate. But this person, Sheikh Nasiruddin, he did not take the food in the golden plate. In fact, he took the food in his palm and then had it. This simply reflects the simplicity and the auspiciousness of the teachings of Nizamuddin Aulia, his teacher or peer Nizamuddin Aulia. Okay, the tomb of Nizamuddin Aulia is located in Delhi. So basically, first part is basically Muinuddin Chishti was the founder of Chishti Silsila or Chishti order. Then one of the important, what we say, Sufi saint of this order was Baba Farid, who is also referred as Baba Fariduddin Ganj-e-Shakar. Balban was the follower of Baba Farid. Then one of the important saints of this order was the Sufi saint Muhammad, Nizamuddin Aulia. Then there was a Sufi saint of this order again, Sheikh Hamid Uddin Nagauri. I repeat, Sheikh Hamid Uddin Nagauri. Why he is called as Nagauri? Because Nagaur is a place in Rajasthan. And the place of his activities was in Nagaur in Rajasthan. That is why he is referred as Sheikh Hamid Uddin Nagauri. Okay. And he adopted a local language for giving his own teachings. Getting the points clear? And now basically the Chishti order evolved at other places, like in the Deccan city of Bijapur. Okay. Now in the Bengal region also, Chishti order was introduced by Sufi saint Sirajuddin. Okay. And the practices that were followed by Chishti saints or Chishti Sufis include pass e anfas, which simply means control of breath. Okay. It is nothing but control of breath basically improves the meditative practices. Okay. And chilai makus, which is nothing but a yogic practice. So through the entire Chishti silsila, we can understand one important aspect, that Sufism is nothing but mix of Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and to an extent Christianity. So hope so, my friends, you understood the Chishti Silsila, because these Silsila are very, very important from exam perspective. And time and again, there have been questions in the exam, which among the following Sufi saint belonged to the Chishti Silsila? Which Sufi saint had seen the reign of seven Sultan? So it was Nizamuddin Auliya. He belonged to which order? Chishti order or Chishti Silsila. So hope so, my friends, the points are clear. So this is majorly about the Chishti order or the Chishti Silsila. So please majorly focus on the terminologies. Time and again, I have said you one important thing, that terminologies are very, very important from the exam perspective, and they play a very crucial role in the exam. Okay. Now, let us discuss about Suhrawardi order. Now, why it is referred as Suhrawardi order? Now, let us understand. Suhrawardi Silsila or Suhrawardi order of Sufism was founded by Sheikh Shahabuddin Suhrawardi at a place called as Baghdad, which is in Iraq. Okay. After finding this Silsila, he sent one of his disciples to India to establish Suhrawardi order in India. Okay, now Suhrawardi order in India was founded by Bahauddin Zakaria. Please remember the name. Suhrawardi order initially was not established in India. It was established in Baghdad by Shahabuddin Suhrawardi. His disciple was sent to India to establish this Sufi order in India, and his name was Bahauddin Zakaria. Now, at that point of time, Chishti order was prevalent in various parts of India. Like it was prevalent in Bengal, Bihar, certain parts of Delhi, Rajasthan, certain parts of Punjab, Deccan, and so on. And now Suhrawardi order was basically established in the region of Punjab and Sindh. And the major role that was played was being played by Bahauddin Zakaria. Okay. Now he established his khanqah at a place called as Multan. Now, exactly opposed to Chishtis, they had their different ideology. They worked on different principle. Now they believed one important aspect. If you remember the Chishti Sufi saint, they believed that basically the saint, the Sufi saint, should not befriend the kings and the nobles. They need to live an austere and a simple life. Exactly opposed was Suhrawardi order. They believed that the Sufi saints should not believe in life of poverty and torturing their body. They should live a balanced and a comfortable life. Secondly, they actively participated in the political affairs. Like Chishtis believed that there is a difference between the religion and the state. There is a difference between the religion and the politics, and both should be segregated and not intermingled. And completely opposed to this was Suhrawardi order. They believed that basically religion and the state are similar, and they took keen interest in the political affairs. Okay, like as per Chishti Sufi saint, everybody is same in the eye of God. Everybody should be same in the eye of a saint. Rather it be a common man, rather it be a noble or a king. But these people, they avoided, Suhrawardi order saints, they avoided the company of ordinary man. Okay, they enjoyed the company of the king and the nobles. Why? Because they wanted to acquire higher position in the political affairs through religious affair. That is why they avoided the company of common man. Now basically, Sufi saint should renounce his worldly possessions, as I have told you previously. But the saints of Suhrawardi orders, they accepted lot of land and gifts from the kings and the nobles. Okay, so Suhrawardi order, it completely reflects a different side of Sufi movement. Now, after the death of Suhrawardi, of Bahauddin Zakaria, Suhrawardi order split up in two parts. One of the branch was established at Multan, and the second branch was established at Uch in Sindh. I repeat, one of the branches of Suharwardi order, was established in Multan, okay, and the second was established at Uch in Sindh. The branch at Multan was being handled by son of Zahauddin Bakariya, whose name was Zakariya, whose name was Badruddin Arif. Okay, after the death of Bahauddin Zakariya, okay, his, what we say, entire Suharwardi order was being divided into two parts. Please listen carefully and understand this patiently. It was divided into two parts. One branch was at Multan and the second branch was at Uch, which is in Sindh. The branch which was in Multan was being handled by son of Zakariya, whose name was basically Badruddin Arif. I repeat, Badruddin Arif. And the branch at Uch in Sindh, okay, I repeat, the branch at Uch in Sindh was being handled by whom? Jalaluddin Bukhari. Okay, now Badruddin Arif was a very liberal Sufi saint. Now he had inherited 7 lakh tankas from his father, because as I've told you, his father believed that he accepted lots of donations, he accepted lot of gift in the form of land and money from the kings and the nobles. So this money came to whom? Badruddin Arif. He inherited approximately around 7 lakh tanka. And now he, what we say, managed the entire Khanka for 23 years in the region of Multan. And he completely used that 7 lakh tanka for the welfare of underprivileged section of the society. And he believed one important aspect. For a Sufi saint, money is not important. Service to humanity and service to mankind is much more important than accruing lot of wealth. This was the thinking of Badruddin Arif. So whatever money that he had accrued, whatever money that he had inherited from his father, okay, it was spent for the welfare of the society. It was spent for the welfare of the basically underprivileged section of the society. And the other place was basically Uch, which was in Sindh. And the head of this branch was Jalaluddin Bukhari. Now, he got converted many Hindus into Islam basically. So this is majorly about the Suharwardi order. Now, as I have told you, please remember the points again. Suharwardi order was actually founded in the region of Baghdad, which is in Iraq. It is referred as Suharwardi because it was being founded by Shahabuddin Suharwardi. Now he sent one of his disciples to India, okay, whose name was Zakariya. He established Suharwardi order in the region of Punjab and Sindh. Then, after his death, two branches were established of Suharwardi order. One was at Multan, other was at Uch, which is in Sindh. The branch at Multan was being handled by his son, whose name was Badruddin Arif, who was a very liberal Sufi saint. And the branch at Uch in Sindh was being handled by Jalaluddin Bukhari. Okay, hope so the points are clear till here, my friends. Now the other, what we say, the other saints who belong to this order were Jalaluddin Tabrizi. Okay, now he is said to have converted lot many people in the, what we say, Bengalis into the Islam. Now, in very simple words, what did Suharwardi order focus on? They focus that it is not necessary that Sufi saints should completely renounce their worldly life. Okay. Because this was the thinking of the Sufi order Chishtis. But this thinking was not being followed by Suharwardi order. So they believe that Sufi should possess three important things: property, knowledge and hal. They should have money, they should have assets, they should have knowledge. And hal basically means they should basically also know about the mystical side of the Islam, apart from the ritualistic practices. Now, they did not believe in extreme austerity, as I have given you an example in the end. Okay, Chilaya Makus. It is nothing but a sort of yogic practices which was being followed by Sufi saint of Chishti order. So basically, these saints did not believe in extreme self-mortification. They did not believe in extreme austerity. And they actively took part in the politics. Okay. So, If there is a question in the mains, basically, what is the difference between the Chishtis and Suharwardis? We have already discussed about this. But still, we'll go for a small discussion about the Chishtis and Suharwardis in short. As I've told you, for Chishtis, accumulation of wealth was not important. In fact, they believed in very simple life. They believe in life of simplicity and humility. Because they believe that through wealth, basically, if they are having any sort of asset, physical asset, or basically if they are having wealth or money, their mind will continuously cling to that money. And this is a sort of hindrance in the spiritual progress of an individual. This was being taught by whom? Of Chishtis. And basically, Suharwardis believe that wealth, it is not necessary to renounce your worldly life. And wealth was not harmful for a man until and unless he actually knows the right use of that wealth. Okay? Then, Chishtis believe that the politics and the religion are completely separate. And there should be no interference between the religion and the politics. Why? Because religion focuses on simplicity. Politics majorly focuses on the administrative aspect. And when both of them are mixed, there would be a complete chaotic situation. So this was a belief of Chishtis. And Suharwardis were exactly opposite to this. They believed that, in fact, they should have a very good relation with the king and the nobles. Because building up good relations with the king and the nobles would provide them a higher position in the society. Okay? Then, Chishtis believe that rather it be a common man, rather it be a noble, rather it be a basically a king, the doors of these saints are open to everyone, irrespective of the social background, irrespective of the economic background, and sometimes irrespective of the religion as well. Okay? But they believe that, Suharwardi believe that, the Khanka was being accommodated by the influential people. And they gave much more importance to the influential people because they believed that if they have a company of influential people, they will have a lot of influence in the politics and the religion both. That is why they did not give much more importance to the ordinary men and gave more importance to the politically influenced people. Okay? Music. Music, as I've told you, Sufi saint, they also believed in something called as musical congregation. Like in Hinduism, we have a practice called as bhajan and kirtan. These bhajans and kirtan are the means to come nearer to the God. Similarly, musical congregation called as sama, we have discussed about this previously. Musical congregation called as sama was a part which was a musical practice which was being followed by the Sufi saint. So the Sufi saints of Chishti order, they believed in Sama. But this was being rejected completely by the saint of Suharwardi order. Okay, then Chishtis allowed their disciple to practice Sajda. I have told you one important aspect, my friends. When we had studied in the medieval India, in the Delhi Sultanate, about Balban. Now Balban was the ruler of slave dynasty and he had introduced two important systems. That is Sajda and Paibos. Sajda basically means bowing in front of the king in respect. That is also referred as prostration. And basically, Paibos means kissing the Sultan feet. So Sajda basically means bowing in front of the Sufi saint in respect. So basically, Chishtis followed this practice. But Suharwardis did not follow this practice. To an extent, we can observe that the saint of the Chishti Silsila were quite liberal in their thought. They were quite liberal in their ideas. And exactly opposed to this was Suharwardi. They were not liberal in their ideas. The teachings of Suharwardi, or what we say, order, reflected a sort. The teachings reflected a sort of what? A sort of rudimentary ideas. Okay, or orthodox ideas. So my friends, hope so, in a very systematic fashion, in a very simplistic order, you understood the difference between Chishtis and Suharwardis. Okay? Okay. Now let us understand about another important Chishti order or another important Chishti silsila. Sorry, another important Sufi silsila. That is Naqshbandi silsila. Now what it is all about? Naqshbandi, it was being founded by Bahauddin Naqshbandi. But basically it is said that this movement gained, or this order gained more prominence and it became more flourishing during the, what we say, Sufi saints Sheikh Baqi Billah and Sheikh Ahmad Sirhindi, and specifically during the reign of Sheikh Ahmad Sirhindi. Okay, I repeat, Bahauddin Naqshbandi was the founder of this order. He had two important followers. One was Baqi Billah and other was Ahmad Sirhindi. Baqi Billah was the follower or disciple of Ahmad Sirhindi. Okay, now Ahmad Sirhindi was completely opposed. Excuse me. Ahmad Sirhindi was completely opposed to the ideas of Shias and Hindus, and he believed that Islam and Hinduism are completely opposed to each other. They are antithesis. Okay, and there is no reconsolidation being possible between the two. And he enjoyed a lot of support by one of the orthodox rulers whose name was Aurangzeb. Okay. Now it is said that he had written his first pamphlet, Rad-e-Rafavid. I repeat, Rad-e-Rafavid. It was written against the Shia principles. Okay. Now, what did this order majorly focus upon? Strict observance of Sharia. That is Islamic law. My friends, I have told you in the principles that there were two types of Sufi saint, Bashara and Beshara. Bashara means those who strictly followed the Islamic law, and Beshara basically means those who are not bound by the Islamic law. So they believed that, they believed in staunch followings of Shariat law. They believed in Bashara. As I have told you, music, as per Sufism, as per the core principles of Sufism, they believed that music is a way to come closer to the God, and the relation between the God is of the loved and the beloved one. And here they completely oppose the system of music. Okay. Now, basically, another important thing, they believe that the relation between the God and the man is not of the loved and the beloved one. It is like a master and the slave. And they were completely opposed to the liberal ideas that were being initiated by Mughal Emperor Akbar. Okay, I'll give you very few examples of it. Like, Akbar had many Rajput wives and he respected all other religions. He gave due respect to Hinduism as well. Like, in Islam, basically, idol worship is being prohibited. But you can find there are instances where there are idols of Lord Krishna as well there in the palaces of Akbar. Why? Because he had many Rajput wives. Secondly, he had started one religion basically. We are going to study that in detail when we are going to study about the Mughal emperors. So basically, he had started a religion which is referred as Din-e-Ilahi. Now, Din-e-Ilahi encompassed the principles of all the religions. It was quite liberal in nature. Okay, like Birbal, we are going to study about him as well. Birbal, who was one of the courtiers in the court of Akbar, was a staunch follower of Din-e-Ilahi, which was being initiated by Akbar. Now, Akbar completely abolished the jizya system, which was a pilgrim tax on the Hindus. So all these liberal aspects and all the liberal ideas of Akbar was being opposed by the saints of Naqshbandi order, because they completely believed in the staunch following of Islam. So this is majorly about Naqshbandi order. Hope so the points are clear, my friends. Now, Kshatri Silsila, a very important one. Another important Silsila is Kshatri Silsila. Now, what is Kshatri Silsila all about? Let us understand this. It was founded, or it became popular during the reign of Lodi dynasty rulers. And it was founded by Muhammad Ghauth in the region of Gwalior. Okay. Now, the Sufi saints of Kshatri Silsila, okay, also reflect liberal ideas. Excuse me. Also reflect liberal ideas. Why? Because we can see here that the saints of this order also studied the Sanskrit text. Okay, they also studied about the yogic practices. They studied about the Vedantic philosophy. And all these things are reflected in the principles of the saints of Kshatriya order or Kshatriya Silsila. Okay, like Tansen, one of the great musicians, then Humayun, they were quite attracted towards the Kshatriya Silsila. They were the staunch follower of Kshatriya Silsila, which majorly focused upon simple life. They encompassed the teachings of various other religions, which was quite, what we say, liberal in nature. How it can be reflected? As we have seen an example, the saints of this order studied the Vedantic philosophy. They studied the Upanishadic philosophy. They gave much more emphasis on the Hindu Sanskrit text. This simply explains one important aspect, that they were quite liberal in comparison to the other Sufi orders. Hope so. The points are clear, my friends. Now, next is Kadri Silsila. Now, let us understand about the Kadri Silsila or Kadri order. Okay. Kadri order was being founded by Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani of Baghdad in Iraq. And he had a disciple called as Shah Niyamatullah. I repeat, this order was being founded by Abdul Qadir Jilani. And he had a disciple in the form of Shah Niyamatullah. Okay. Niyamatullah popularized the Kadri Silsila or the Kadri order in India. Now, he believed that continuously thinking about the heaven and hell, continuously focusing on the basically prayers, basically, there is much more need. There is need to majorly emphasize on simple life, on simple livelihood and true love towards God. Because if one shows respect towards humanity, one shows respect towards the mankind, one shows respect towards the Allah, or once he serves for the underprivileged section of the society, it is nothing but service to God. In very, very simple words, very simple language, service to mankind, service to humanity, service to man is nothing but service to God. Okay? Now, they were opposed to music and dance, as Chishti Silsila believed in, unlike the Chishti Silsila. And the followers of Kadri Silsila wore green turbans. You might have seen these. This basically, they majorly wear green turban. Now, Dara Shikoh, he was son of Shah Jahan, who was a Mughal emperor. Okay, it is said that Dara Shikoh, we have studied about him in the ancient India as well, that he had translated more than 50 Upanishads into Persian language. And Dara Shikoh, who was a son of Shah Jahan, was follower of Kadri Silsila. Hope so the points are clear, my friends. As I have told you previously, right from the very first session, guys, that in medieval India, you majorly need to focus upon the terminologies. And terminologies plays a very crucial role in the medieval India, as I have time and again repeatedly focused upon these aspects. So, my friends, please do revise the Sufi movement. Please do revise the important terminologies, because today we have been through lots of terminologies, lots of names. Yes, I understand that you might feel that these names are quite difficult to memorize. But once you read it properly, once you patiently go through these names, automatically you are going to understand this. Okay, like we have studied what is Peer, what is Murid, what is Wahadat ul Wajud, what is Ruh, what is Sama, what is Khanka, what is Darga. Okay, so these are the important terminologies that we have studied today. And please go for answer writing practice on daily basis, because answer writing practice is again a very crucial thing in the civil services exam. Getting the points clear, my friends? So, hope so you understood the important aspects of the Sufi movement. Hope so you like the lectures. Please do subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. I repeat, please use my code AKOUS. Thank you and have a very, very nice day. Thank you.